This is Metal Mike, and in this episode of the 80s Glam Metalcast, I talk to a vocal legend from MSG fame and from the new band Black Swan, Robin McAuley. Robin goes in depth on the new Black Swan album, Shake the World, and talks about some of his past projects. Check it out.
Welcome to the 80s Glam Metalcast, Robin. How you doing tonight?
I'm doing great. Thanks for calling in, and hope your day's going great.
Yes, yes. Well, hey, this Black Swan album, Shake the World, is just amazing. The internet's buzzing over it. You've got to be excited about the response.
Yeah, you know, it kind of sideswiped us. We didn't expect so much great positive comments. It's been really cool since we released it on Valentine's Day, and it just keeps getting better. But we're very happy with the record. You know, when you start something like this, at my stage anyway, you're thinking, what are we going to do? And, you know, you end up performing and recording with amazing talents like Jeff Pilson and Red Beach and Matt Starr. And how can you go wrong, Mike, right?
Yeah, you can't. You know, listening to this album, you know, I get kind of go back where I feel like I'm back in the 80s and the early 90s where, you know, good songwriting, the melodic hooks. I mean, that was just the way, you know, back in the day. And that's what I'm getting that vibe
right.
Again.
Yeah. You know, when Jeff called me on this, he'd already spoken to Reb, and Reb says, sure, if we can write songs together, but, you know, they'd worked together on a previous Dokken record.
Yes.
And Warner had just come off the road with Whitesnake shows. So he called Reb, and Reb says, well, if we can write songs, I'm totally in for it. Then he calls me. I've known Jeff. Jeff was actually my best man 27 years ago this October.
Okay.
So we go back quite a ways. I was totally up for it. We got together, and, you know, I said, what are they looking for? They being the record company. And he said, yeah, you know, Frontiers loves classic rock, so that's what they want. And we kind of chuckled, and we went, okay, let's give them a classic rock record. And, you know, Shake the World was what came out of it.
How does the songwriting on this album shake out? Did you write a lot of the lyrics and the melodies?
Yeah, they would send me the music. You know, very difficult to schedule everything because, you know, Reb lives in Pittsburgh. And Jeff, Matt, and myself, we live in L.A. where we are kind of within a 40-minute radius of each other. So Reb would come to the studio whenever he'd have the time, and likewise with Jeff. Jeff's home studio, which was awesome. And they would start, you know, woodshedding, send me some ideas, and wherever I was, I work a Vegas show night. 5 nights a week, a show called Raiding the Rock Vault, going into our 7th year with almost like 1,500 shows under our belt.
Nice.
And I'd start working on melodies and lyrics. I'd come back to Jeff, see when he was going to be home. We would do a little pre-production, change a word here, change a whole section there, and I'd go, I don't like this part, but that part, switch it around, and I'd step up to the mic. And we'd record a song every time I'd be there. That's kind of how we accumulated everything and then sifted through to see what we had. So there was a couple of songs like The Rock That Rolled Away. Jeff basically came through with that idea as he did with Divided United, which was very influenced by him watching Bohemian Rhapsody, the Queen movie. And he was so taken by it, he came straight back to his house, sat at the piano, and started writing that, and he sent it. He was sending me MP3s at like midnight or something. He was so excited about it. And, Do you like it? I go, dude, I'm half asleep. You know, and I'd call him the next morning, and I went over and, you know, put my take on it. But the song kind of remained the same, basically, from his initial idea. And it was a real great collaborative process. You know, we all know what we're capable of doing, and, you know, there was no egos involved. No, I don't like that. It has to be my way. That doesn't make for a band, you know.
No.
So, the results are great. It's the collaborative effort really shows in the strength of the writing. And, you know, we all come from different places, but there's a great cohesiveness on the Black Swan record that I particularly like. Probably the best thing I've ever done, as I've told many people.
Yeah, and what's cool about it is, like you said, it has its own sound, but you can hear elements of the previous bands you guys have been in kind of creep in, and for a fan, I think that's pretty cool.
Yeah, well, it's hard to deny that because, you know, of what we've all done, and we are who we are at the end of the day. You know, if I write with Michael Schenker, you're going to get what it is that I do. The same as with Jeff Pilson, you know, if he's producing a Foreigner record or he's doing a Dokken record, you're going to hear Jeff Pilson as you do with Reb and Winger. I think what's really cool about this is that Reb really came through. He came through the thunderstorm of this. I mean, he is just he's everything. He got nasty on this record, and it's really Reb Beach. Just he's killing it. It's just incredible. In fact, most people say I haven't heard Reb really come into his own so much as he has on this, and I agree. I think, I mean, he's a phenomenal player. His depth of melody is just awesome, and he just brought it. It's just killer. Same with Matt Starr. You know, it was kind of ass backwards with how we did the drums, because, you know, Jeff initially didn't want to play bass, and so Reb and I had other ideas about that. So thankfully, and then Jeff also had, you know, a bunch of drummers that he thought would fit the mold. And by the time we got through writing the material, again, because of scheduling, those drummers were no longer available. And so the label said, what about Matt Starr? And I had worked the Vegas show with Matt, because Matt's one of our swing drummers. And I'd done some events with him in Hollywood. He's also an amazing singer, which not a lot of people know.
Okay.
And he really is. So Matt came in and he absolutely brought the thunder on this. I mean, he just brought so many ideas in, slammed it down. The songs were already written that Jeff and him worked together. And because we had a drum machine as like a guide for the tracks, and he came in and he slaughtered it. It's just, it's awesome. Huge drum sound. So again, thanks to Jeff's production, he really brought He brought the game, as they say.
Yeah, the production is incredible on it. And when you think of some of the songs, like, I know, I think the whole album sounds great, but do you have some favorites that kind of stand out? Do you have a couple of favorite songs on there?
You know, there was a couple of songs that meant different things. You know, When Johnny Comes Marching was close to home, because I was actually in Europe with Schenkerfest when that massacre took place, not 25 minutes from my front door here in California. Mm-hmm. And one of my sons had been there the week before, and he had a bunch of his college buddies there on that night. And when I read the headlines, and, you know, you're miles away, and you know, you can't be home to support, when that music came in from Jeff and Reb, they had ideas to take it a different direction, and I kept hearing this idea, and so I came back to Jeff and I told him, you know, I need it to be like this, and, you know, put the marching drums on it, and it's basically like, you know, our servicemen and women who come back home from those god awful wars that we fight, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Not properly acclimated, not counseled, and the rest we know, because it's all too prevalent, you know, the news these days. And so that's where that whole idea came from. By contrast, of course, you know, Immortal Souls, when they sent me a piece of music to get ideas going on that one, I kept hearing this howling wolf at the beginning of the guitar riff. So I came back to Jeff with this whole idea about vampires, because I love vampire movies. And I went, dude, it's so cool how Reb got that sort of howling wolf at the beginning of the song. And he goes, how much coffee have you had this morning? Because there's no howling wolf at the beginning of that song. And I went, no, there is. There it is. You know? So it was that kind of a thing. And by contrast, yet again, the very first idea that they sent to me, just to see how this whole thing would fly, I came to the studio when Reb and Jeff were there together. And I said, hey, guys, you want to hear what I got for this? So I start singing it down, and it was the very first song we wrote. It was a big disaster. And Reb starts laughing, and he goes, "You know, dude, this is the first time we've actually worked together on any kind of project, and you come in with a lyric, and it's titled Big Disaster." He goes, "Where is it going to go from here?" And that was kind of the mood, you know. It was like, I went, don't rely on me to come up with ideas that you think I'm going to come up, because it's not going to be like that at all. And so we let it fly, and you know, it turned out great, you know.
Yeah, I love all those too, and one that really catches my ears is the melody is She's On To Us, and it's just it's kind of a funny song too.
Yeah, you know, that's actually based on a real life good friend of mine, and it's a real easy story, because it was, you know, it was something that she had been talking to us about, and this person is actually a private investigator. And who got married.
Okay.
And her glorious husband thinks that he can cheat on her without she actually finding out.
Bad move.
And it's kind of based around, yes, really, what a dumb shit. So it's based around that whole thing, and she goes, "You can't write about this." And I said, "Well, there's no names mentioned, you know, but I'm going to use this whole circumstance to to treat my lyrics as such." And, it's actually based around something that actually happened. So I had plenty of information to feed off before She's On To Us, you know.
That's awesome. Well, you know, with a lot of times with music and lyrics too, it's subjective, right? Just like when you said you heard the howling wolf that wasn't there.
Absolutely. It can mean several different things for several different people. So, and that's how I kind of structure the lyrics. So it's like, it could be you, it could be about your cat, you know.
Yeah. I remember I watched an interview with Freddie Mercury one time, and I don't know, they were asking about a certain song, and he goes, you know, sometimes
Speaking of cats, right, because he loved his cats.
Yeah, that's right. And he, you know, he said, sometimes it's good just to keep it vague and let the listener figure out what the story is in their own head. You know what I mean? Don't get too specific.
Absolutely. Yeah. I remember back in the Schenker days, when Anytime was getting a lot of radio play, we would do all of these interviews. And I remember one day this female journalist, who shall remain nameless, and she started talking to me, and suddenly she broke down. I mean, she was crying uncontrollably. And she goes, "You have no idea what that song did to my life." And I'm going, shit, I should run outside and shoot myself right now, you know? because, you know, the power of the pen, Mike, you know?
Yeah, you're right.
And sometimes you don't really, you can't know. You can't know what it is that you're putting down there, you know, and you're absolutely right. It's all very subjective, because, you know, what means to one person means completely different to somebody else. So I suppose that's good, because, you know, you cover all your bases, I guess, right?
Exactly. So I know that it's going to be tough for you guys to do some live shows because of your schedules and everything. But if you were to do any, is the plan to play songs from the album, but maybe integrate some songs from the various groups you're involved with?
That's a great question. I did an interview together with Jeff, and we were asked the same question. And I guess that would have to be the case, simply because unless we found the time to get together and write another album's worth of material, we just wouldn't have enough material to pad out a set. So I'm sure that you'd get something from all of us, previous bands, and who knows what else thrown in for it, you know. Yeah, I think it would have to be. But it would be an interesting set, I'm sure, you know. Yes would be the answer to that, of course. You know, we'd have to pad it out somehow. And with something that we know that, I hate to use this word, fans, but something that the fans would be eager to listen to, you know. So I'm not too much for playing for myself, you know. It's has to be a purpose to it, so. It'd be fun. I mean, when we go out with Schenker, FYI, you know, we just have to pull the plug on Japan. I'm supposed to be in Japan right now, leaving March 6th, but because of this damn virus, you know, we had the the plug pulled on that one, as did Whitesnake. So I should call Reb because I know he's home.
Yeah, right.
Speaking of opportunity, right, I don't think Pilsen's home, but so we might get time for something, I don't know. With Schenker, of course, and now with four singers for Schenker Fest, you know, we have very different phases with each singer. And then, of course, you know, we always have a whole section dedicated to UFO. So it's an absolute blast because, you know, the show is like 2.5 hours long, but you get to cover a lot of material. So, you know, with Black Swan going out on any kind of a tour or i.e. set of dates, we'd have a lot at our disposal to, you know, to choose from.
Let me pick your brain even further. So if you had your choice, your opportunity to put your own spin on like a Dokken song or a Winger song, any come to mind that you'd like to do?
Oh God, I haven't even thought about it. I don't know. I think Reb would probably be the one that would pick it. You know, Jeff's already been going, "Oh, dude, you'd kill this Whitesnake song," and I'm going, "You know what? I wouldn't do any of that shit. I'd be doing probably Early Faces material. That's what I'd be doing." That's the way I want to go, because that would be my personal favorite. I would stay away from everything. You know, I was a big Early Faces fan, and it's just sleazy, thrashy rock and roll, and it's got an edge to it. So that would be my personal favorite. You know, to hell with those other guys. I don't care what to pick. They can sing it. I'm just kidding.
Well, speaking of singing, I mean, I think everybody is noticing the killer sound of your voice, how intact your voice is. I mean, are you blessed or what? What's going on?
No, I'm definitely blessed. Everybody goes, "What's the secret?" And I'm going, I don't have a secret. There are a number of criteria that's very important to me. First one is the responsibility of just that singing. As long as I intend to go forward singing, I have a responsibility to make sure that I at least sound good. There's a lot of singers, unfortunately, continue to do it, and it's I hate to use this word, but it's a little undignified some of the times, and it's like, you know. But there's a lot to do with how you take care of that responsibility. You know, I work Vegas. I sing 5 nights a week. Have done for going into my 7th year. You know, with almost 1,500 shows. So that's a lot of. That's a lot of singing. It's a lot of exercise. And I stay away from the casinos when I don't have to be there.
Right.
You know, I've never smoked in my life. So to me, that's very, very important. I absolutely enjoy a glass and have been known to be a bottle or two of wine, but never when I'm working. I just don't do it when I'm working. It just doesn't work for me like that. And when you have, you know, a show and producers walking the floor watching the show night after night to a completely new audience. That audience wants to see that show right on the money, night after night. They don't need to hear excuses, blah, blah, blah. So as a singer, I feel I have a responsibility to do the best that I can do. And I take great care of my instrument. It's all I have. And, you know, one day it won't be there. And I hope I have the sense to exit stage left and know when the right time to do that is. So that's and I'm Irish and I'm very proud. So I would hate for people to tell me that I sound like shit. You know, I'm sure they do, and I just can't hear it.
No. And you know what's hard? You know, when you think about
I'm partially deaf.
Are you?
No, I'm not. I'm not.
And I think when you play live, I mean, so a lot of times you can crank up the volume and the instruments and maybe you could drown out a weakness in your voice. But when you're in the studio, I think it's pretty obvious. Like if you don't have it, I mean, I know there's technology, but if it's not there, it's pretty obvious in the studio.
Yeah, I'm going to refer back to the Michael Schenker days. Something that we used to always always talk to each other about was, if you're familiar with how Michael Schenker plays and how he performs live, if there's a solo that you absolutely are to die for on any record that he's ever recorded, I can guarantee you that you will hear that solo live, just like he played it in the studio, and he might put some add-ons, but you will get the bulk of that studio solo, just like he played it on the record. And the same goes for my singing. I never want to record something that I'm not capable of pulling off live, because I know that when I go to see a band live, it's really important for me, especially if I like the band and I like the songs. I feel cheated if I don't hear that song just like I like it. And I expect the same from myself. Yes, when you go live, it's good to, you know, stretch it a little bit and do all of that. But the hook line, the foundation of the song, I think it's important to keep it. So that's just something that I do. And when we did Black Swan, you know, if we go live, you'll hear it like the record. There'll be no messing around. There's no trickery. It's just how it went down, you know. And that's the cool thing about it. That sounds a little cantankerous. It's not meant to be. No trickery. I'm just lucky. And plus the fact, very important, I write melodies that suit what I'm capable of doing. And that's also very important to me. So I'm not going to start writing something and I'm going, I'll make this work in the studio, but I can never do it live. Mm-hmm. I don't do that. It's like, I'm going to do it this way because it's comfortable, it's in my range, and I can powerhouse it to my ability so that I can do it live. And that's really as simple as that. I mean, I don't know what else to tell you.
We touched on MSG. Do you have a favorite album that you worked on with Michael?
Oh, God. You know, unfortunately, for the time that we spent together under the McAuley Schenker period, we didn't really do enough. You know, three albums in 6-7 years wasn't exactly a stretch.
Sure.
You know, Perfect Timing, a lot of people go, it's one of their favorites. I did not like the production on that. Michael didn't like the production on it. It just didn't do what we thought it was going to do. We fixed that on Save Yourself. Save Yourself is probably my favorite in terms of production for what we wanted it to sound like. And then the last one, of course, ironically, Jeff Pilson was on the very last studio, mm-hmm. McAuley Schenker record, the MSG record, together with James Kotak, you know, who ended up with the Scorpions. There's another strange irony, you know.
I know, right?
With Michael and Rudolph, right?
Yes.
Everything's always meant to happen. And, you know, Jeff and James were very good friends of mine, and we'd hang most weeks in Hollywood and that sort of stuff. And when Michael came to me and he goes, I'm thinking maybe because we're here in the States, we should use other people. And I love the guys that was in the McAuley Schenker period. In fact, it's again ironic that Steve Mann is permanently in Schenkerfest, our keyboard player, guitar player,
okay.
As is Bodo Schaff, since we lost poor Ted McKenna last year. So now we have two McAuley Schenker, which Michael was a little skeptical about because, you know, Schenkerfest is not McAuley Schenker, but it just so happens that, you know, they're great players and you can't ignore that. And they're very familiar with the material. So not too much unobvious, that's not a proper word, but you know what I mean. It was the way to go for that. Yeah, Save Yourself, I think, is out of the three, is probably my favorite. I mean, Andy Klem was on there as our first big intro into the charts, although, you know, there were other singles that saw the light of day with MTV. And then, of course, the very last studio one, when we had a great ballad with When I'm Gone, that I co-wrote with Jesse Holmes, who was Sammy Hager's keyboard player.
Oh, nice.
You know, we submitted that record to the label, and they're going, we don't hear the single. and you know, we were always molded to come up with a damn radio-friendly song, because you know, if you didn't have it, you didn't get the tour, and blah, blah. It's just like, you know, you had to fall into this trap of where they put you in a bag and all that sort of stuff. Thank God all of that's gone.
Yeah.
You know, now we just, we write how we please, you know.
I'm surprised that Save Yourself wasn't even a bigger album, because when I think of songs like I Am Your Radio, What We Need, those right. are big rock songs. Those are awesome songs.
Yeah. I don't know what to tell you on that one either. You know, a lot of people go, MSG should have been so much bigger. But, you know, we did what we did, and a lot to do with the people around you and all of that sort of stuff. You know, everything happens for a reason. I always see the positive side of stuff, you know, and here we are today, 30 something years onwards, and you know, happy campers.
We're still talking
we're still
about
doing it. We're still doing it, so you know, yeah, it's all good. It's all good, Mike.
Now, when I've listened to some interviews, and you talk about kind of how you hooked up with Michael and how he was after, he wanted to get you in the band, and you kind of blew him off, and then Rudolph recommended you, and then, you know, things kind of came together. So it sounds like in the past there was a good relationship with Michael and Rudolph, and we all know currently there's just not much of a relationship there. I mean, were they on good terms when you were in the band? What happened there?
They were always on great terms, mm-hmm. and I'm not even sure from the insider, I'm not even sure that they're still not.
Okay.
You know, you have to take a lot of tongue-in-cheek with stuff, because, you know, when Michael steps up to the mic these days, you know, he never used to speak.
Okay.
He would never talk on stage. He'd say nothing. He wouldn't introduce a song. He wouldn't do anything, because he would always say to me, my job is to play guitar. You do the talking. And I'm not a big talker on stage. I don't really like all of that sort of stuff.
Right.
You know, my job is singing. I'm not a comedian. I have no funny jokes to tell you. You know, I can't make it up and all that sort of stuff. And I'm there for the entertainment value. And that's really important to me. That it has to be entertaining. Because if I go to a show, entertain me. Don't just go, you know, whatever's that comes to you because you think it's funny, because I don't think it's funny. And Michael goes on a bit, and he has done for the last couple of tours, you know, his whole relationship with Rudolph. But there's a little thing that people forget that he always sticks in, you know. I wrote this song, and Rudolph asked me for this song, and I said, okay, Rudolph, you can have this song. Am I a good brother or what? And everybody laughs, and it's a great time. There's a lot of tongue in cheek, you know. It's always good to have a little. Of course, I may be saying the wrong thing here. I should be telling you, they absolutely hate each other, because that makes a better headline than to say no, they absolutely love each other. Of course, you know. So then you fall foul to the game, you know.
That's how you get on Blabbermouth and all these websites, Robin. You know.
Of course, dude. Of course, you know, it's like, what, was I born yesterday? You know, you take a quote from Robin McAuley, he absolutely hates his brother. There you have it.
Got it.
That'll make the headlines. But you should never, there's an old saying, you know, you should never get involved with family squabbles. So
yeah.
I take the fifth, right?
I don't blame you. What was it like being in Survivor? I mean, you got to play all those killer songs.
Yeah. Oh, man, what a great catalog of great material. Not unlike Michael Schenker, I refused to join Survivor back in 1994. I had an opportunity. Frankie Sullivan and I wrote a whole bunch of tunes that became a solo record for me called Business as Usual. Frankie said I should join Survivor. I said, Survivor is a pop band. I don't need to join Survivor. And he went, hey. And he goes, no, it is a rock band. I goes, no, it is not a rock band. So we would have this, you know, backwards and forwards. And about 4 years after that initial working together, I got all of these emails from Frankie going, you know, you're ready to do it now, and blah, blah, blah. And my line always was, call Jimmy, get Jimmy back in the band,
right,
and stop all of this other stuff that was going on. And, you know, after 5 or 6 years with me and Survivor, that actually happened, where they brought back in Dave Bickler and Jimmy together. And,
okay,
of course, Jimmy barely lasted the year before he passed, which was shocking.
Mm-hmm.
Because he was a tremendous singer, a lovely person, a lovely man, just great songwriting, and I enjoyed my time in there. I didn't really feel I fitted the part. It wasn't something that I wanted to do. Frankie wanted me to do it. Mm-hmm. But I did it, and I had a great time. And I had an opportunity to sing those just awesome songs, whether people loved it or hated it, you know. I tried to keep the integrity of the songs as my voice would treat them. Because, you know, when you go out to see a Survivor concert, people go, he doesn't sound anything like Jimmy Jamison or Dave Pickler. I mean, just to add to that, I remember doing a meet and greet one night, and I'm standing beside Frankie in a whole line of people, and this couple came up and deadpan said to me, oh, you're not wearing your beret tonight? And Frankie goes, no, sometimes he doesn't. Now, here's a guy and his wife that are purportedly huge Survivor fans and can't tell me from a stone in the ground.
Right.
Right? So that's kind of what you're confronted. It's like, listen to the, if you're going to listen to the music, be a fan, love it, but at least know who's singing it, you know, or playing it, or the drummer is. Yeah. And often that really is the case. They're going, dude, I love your work with, what was his name? I can't remember his
name. You're a big fan then, right?
Right? And it happens. And it's like, you know, if you're up there, what are you supposed to say? Oh, no, let me walk you through this. You know, and I'm not being facetious, but it's true. It happens sometimes. My time with Survivor was I had a blast. You know, when it was over, it was time to be over, if not sooner. You know, I'm in a great place. I love everything I've done. I've been very, very, very fortunate to have had the opportunity to walk out on stage with all of the people that I've had the opportunity to do. You know, I recently, we did a show with Tony Franklin came into Raiding the Rock Vault, and I've known Tony for years, and he's just, you know, he's just an amazing bass player. And yes, you know, Tony Franklin played with the firm, for God's sake.
Yep. Yeah, he's played a lot
right?
of people.
Right? So, you know, I'm still in awe of people like that, you know, and it's a great ride. It really is. I mean, what an opportunity. I'm an Irish lad, you know, came from nothing, and I get to strut my stuff with all of these with these great players. I mean, what a dream come true. It's awesome.
Well, in closing, Robin, what do you want to say to the fans that have followed you for all these years?
Oh my God. Thank you for listening to the Black Swan record. We're absolutely stoked at the reaction that we've had to this record. Absolutely 100% sincerely hope that we can come and play in front of you live with this, and that you'll come and check it out. And if you don't catch me with Black Swan, maybe with Schenkerfest somewhere along the line this year. Stay safe, stay well, and keep listening.
Awesome.
And shake the world. Let's do it together.
Thanks for the conversation, Robin.
You are very welcome, Mike. Thank you so much for your time.
Take care.
What an awesome interview with Robin. That guy is a riot. Well, hey, we're all laying low here because of the crisis. I'll keep pumping out the episodes, and I hope you all stay safe, stay healthy. Rock on!